Despite all of the ways you can now get tested for COVID-19, not all of those tests apparently are accurate. Meg, you have the latest now on the state of testing around this country.
That's right, Scott. And as testing has ramped up, modeling groups are still saying we're not doing enough. In fact, one really prominent group from Harvard saying testing levels need to be at least 3 times higher per day than we're currently doing, around 900,000 tests. Right now, as you can see, in the last 7 days, we've been averaging around 300,000 tests per day. They also are taking a look at this on a state-by-state basis. And data from the COVID tracking project show on a per capita basis, states like New York, Rhode Island, Massachusetts, they're doing the most. But if you look at the Harvard group's modeling numbers, they show there are several states that are still not at the threshold they need to be based on the size of their outbreaks. About 14 states and Washington, D.C., not hitting that testing level they need to be testing. And also showing a percent positive rate of the tests getting returned of more than 10%, which the WHO has suggested means they're potentially missing infections. And of course, as testing is expanding, there are also concerns you mentioned about the test's accuracy. 3 different kinds of tests on the market in the United States all have potential possibilities for false negatives. For the most common tests, called PCR tests, that rate is estimated to be about 5 to 30%. For antibody tests, which test for prior infection, that can go as high as 10% under the FDA's tightened guidelines. And for the newest kind of tests, those are antigen tests, the FDA says that negative results do not rule out infection. And in fact, one test getting a lot of attention around that this week is Abbott's ID Now test, as there was an NYU study that just came out suggesting that can miss a third to half of positive samples. However, people are coming out saying that might not be the best analysis. And Abbott, in a new statement tonight, saying we're seeing studies being conducted to understand the role of the ID Now test in ways they say it was not designed to be used. The NYU study results, they say, are not consistent with other studies and relied on a small sample size. Still, Scott, this is causing a lot of concern, as this is the main test that we've heard being used in the White House. I talked with Dr. Michael Osterholm about this, an infectious diseases expert at the University of Minnesota, who said using this test to screen at the White House would be like giving squirt guns to the Secret Service. Scott.
Meg, appreciate it. I'll bring back in Dr. Gottlieb. Dr. Gottlieb, it sounds like in some respects we're taking 2 steps forward and 1 step back when it comes to testing. I go back to what Dr. Bright said today about the outbreak itself. Would it, quote, get worse and be prolonged if we didn't quickly have a national testing strategy? Is this too much of a free-for-all?
Well, I think we're going to have a lot of testing capacity heading into the fall and really heading into the summer. I think we'll be able to conduct millions of tests a week and probably heading towards 10 million. Brett Girard testified before Congress yesterday and said we'll be able to do 10 million tests a week heading into September. That's probably right, because that's owing to a lot of new technology that's going to come on the market, more point-of-care tests, more antigen-based tests where doctors can test right in their offices very inexpensively. I think what we need to do is make sure, one, testing is accessible, so we have sites that can offer testing. That's going to be the challenge, not the testing platforms. And two, that we're using the right testing platform for the right purpose. And so the machines like the Abbott machine, the Rapid machine that the White House is using, or the antigen-based test like the one that was approved by Keitel over the weekend, we will have millions of those tests available. Those should really be used in a doctor's office because they're specific, meaning that if they say you have coronavirus, you do. But they're not uniformly sensitive, so they will tell some patients they don't have the virus when they do. Now, in a doctor's office, that's okay because the doctor's probably going to send off a confirmatory test anyway just to be sure if they get a negative result. So if you can rapidly screen out 85 or 90% of people and say they do have coronavirus, for the 10% where it says they don't, you might test them with something else. PCR is good for if you want more sensitivity and specificity, a more reliable test. But you can't do it at scale. And in a manufacturing site or a workplace where you want to do things at scale, you're going to want to look at pooled testings, pooled samples, where you might take 50 employees and have them spit in a cup and test the whole cup at once. And then if you get a positive, then you'll test each individual employee. For that, there's different platforms available, including next-generation sequencing, which is a good tool for that. I'm on the board of Illumina, a company that makes those tools. But there's different technologies for different purposes. We need to make sure we're fitting the right technology to the right purpose.
Don't want to let you go before I get your comment on another concerning story, certainly to everybody, especially parents. Now more than 100 cases of that new syndrome affecting children in New York. And now some disturbing new details, Dr. Gottlieb, about a new report out of Italy. What can you tell us?
Well, there was a paper published in The Lancet that looked at 30 cases of what appears to be the same syndrome in Italy. About 20 of them occurred just in the last month or so, and then 10 occurred the 5 years prior. So it looks like there's sort of a preponderance of these cases more recently, which is certainly suggestive that it's happening coincident with the coronavirus outbreak, and it's suggestive that there might be a relationship. We haven't been able to establish that there's a relationship, but the fact that we're seeing so many of these cases, and usually these are pretty rare conditions, Kawasaki's syndrome in particular, and the fact that the people who are presenting, the kids who are presenting, are either positive for coronavirus active infection or have antibodies indicating that they had prior infection is certainly suggestive. And that's why everyone's so concerned that there's a relationship between these cases and the virus. But we haven't established that yet.
Last question. A new study suggesting that speaking can produce droplets that stay in the air for at least 8 minutes. That sounds much different than what we learned from the outset, or at least what we thought we knew about this virus from the beginning.
Yeah, it gets to the question of does this become airborne in the sense that small respiratory droplets that can stay suspended for longer periods of time can transmit the infection? I mean, it's certainly on the continuum of possibility, but the thinking right now among most people is that it's classically respiratory droplets. You need to be in close proximity to someone for an extended period of time. And if you look at most of the studies where we've seen clusters of infection caused by a single individual, it was a situation where that individual was in close proximity to the infected person for an extended period of time. So a lot of the infections, for example, are happening in the home, where you have one sick individual infecting other people in the home. So you're always going to find these outlier cases and studies that demonstrate that this is more transmissible in certain circumstances. But I don't think that that's the overwhelming majority of the infection that's happening.